Good morning. The Nativity mystery, conceived from the Holy Spirit and born from the Virgin Mary, means that God became human, truly human, out of his own grace. The miracle of the existence of Jesus, his climbing down of God, is Holy Spirit and Virgin Mary. Here is a human being, the Virgin Mary, and as he comes from God, Jesus comes also from this human being. Born of the Virgin Mary means a human origin of God. Jesus Christ is not only truly God, he is human like every one of us. He is human without limitation. He is not only similar to us, he is like us. We'll now have our prayer. Good morning and welcome. Our time of waiting is almost over. It's Christmas Eve day, and so happy to see all of you today. Please join me in our call to worship as found in the bulletin. We gather in worship today. Jesus says, I am coming soon.
And we rejoice in our waiting for him.
O Emmanuel, our sovereign and lawgiver.
Desire of the nations and savior of all.
Come and save us, O Lord our God.
Come, Lord Jesus. And may the choir please come forward as the candlelighters come forward as well.
In Advent, we wait for the birth of our Lord and Savior. In Advent, we wait for the coming of our true King and ruler of this world. In Advent, we wait for God's mercy to pour down like a stream. On this fourth Sunday in Advent, we light the candle of hope. As we hope for God's goodness to watch over us, we light the candle of peace. As we pray for God's peace to reign over all the earth, we light the candle of joy as we celebrate the gifts of life, love, and light given to us every day. We light the candle of love as we embrace God's love to us through Christ. Listen to these words from Isaiah 7:14. The Lord will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child. She shall bear a son and name him Emmanuel. God is with us. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen. Our first hymn today is hymn number 2, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Please stand if you are able and join us in hymn number 2. Salvation. Have faith. Do not be afraid. Trust in God's loving kindness and immense love for you, because in this we find the confidence to be honest to ourselves and God about what we've done that separate us from God. Let us confess our sin first in unison and then in the silence of our own hearts. Please join me in our unison prayer of confession. God of the future, you are coming in power to bring all nations under your rule. We confess that we have not expected your kingdom, for we live casual lives, ignoring your promised judgment. We accept lies as truth, exploit neighbors, abuse the earth, and refuse your justice and peace. In your mercy, forgive us. Grant us wisdom to welcome your way, to seek things that will endure when Christ comes to judge the world.
Every valley is lifted up, every mountain made low. Now the glory of the Lord is revealed, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please stand as you are able and embody your spirit to join in the Gloria Patri this morning. Christ, we are made new, and with this knowledge we can find our peace. Let us share a sign of Christ's peace with one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please greet your neighbor with a sign of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Linda. And as we continue to share peace, I do invite the kids forward for a time with me. So today is, of course, Christmas Eve. And I decided that for this morning, we would read a book together. Now, a fun fact about this book, it's from a series called The Fat Cat Books. And there's a little fat cat on every page. So it's kind of a fun little fact about this book. Kind of hidden. Okay. Yeah. So here we go. The star of the King of Christmas. Where will we find him? The heavens where the stars shine. Is the King of Christmas there? No. The sky where the birds fly. Is the King of Christmas there? No. There we go. Okay. The waters where the fish swim. Is the King of Christmas there? No. Do you see the cat? The fields where the beasts roam. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
Where's the cat? I'll let you take this book downstairs so you can find the cat, okay? The tables where the rich eat. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
The thrones where the mighty sit. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
The fort where the soldiers wait. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
The market where the merchants sell. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
The temple where the scribes teach. Is the King of Christmas there?
No.
the star of the King of Christmas, where will we find him? The manger where the animals eat. Is the King of Christmas there? Yes. The cross where animals die. No, where criminals die. Is the King of Christmas there? Yes. The grave where his body was laid. Is the King of Christmas there? No. The word where he promises to be found. Is the King of Christmas there? Yes. Jesus is the King of Christmas. Wherever his word and name are, you will find him too. The end. You want to go take this downstairs to look at it? Okay. Have fun with Miss Kathy. And before they go down, let's say congratulations. They're now big brothers to a little sister. Choir, please come forward for this special music. I think we're over there by the tree.
Walter.
This is going to be interesting.
Thank you, choir. Rejoice, and let's pray together our prayer for illumination as found in the bulletin. Holy God, hope and strength by the power of your Spirit, prepare the way in our hearts for the coming of your word, so that we may see the glorious signs of your promise fulfilled through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes from Samuel 2, chapter 7, verses 1 through 11, and then 16. And it's found on page 245 in your pew Bibles if you would like to read along with us. God's covenant with David. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you, And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a home. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our second reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. You can find this on page 831 of the Pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along as I read. Let us listen now to what the Spirit is saying to us, the church, today. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. God, as we come to this time, help us to sense your love ever more clearly, and help us, O God, to share that love. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm sure you've all heard the phrase, best laid plans. We all have them, right? We all have the ideal way for things to happen in the future, whether it be the near future or the far future. One of my best laid plans that didn't work out was my plan to be a doctor. I've told the ending of this story here very early in my time, so I figured it's okay to tell it again. When I was in eighth grade, I realized that I had the knack to be a doctor. I wanted to become a family practitioner, not like a fancy surgeon or anything, but a doctor who saw their patients year in and year out, the doctor you'd come to when you were well and when you were sick. I had this in mind as my chosen career path through all of high school. In fact, I was in a special program called Health Careers Academy, which gave you internships in your junior and senior year. And I went to college with this pre-med track in mind. But the issue was, even though I enjoyed science in high school, I really didn't enjoy it at all in college. In fact, I was pretty miserable, but I had this goal, and I'm a goal-oriented person. I must accomplish said goal. So it took God literally telling me to go into ministry to shake me out of my best laid plan for my life and to follow God's calling for my life instead. I like to joke that I'm so stubborn, God had to interrupt my perfectly good lunch. Otherwise, I never would have gotten the hint. My best laid plan for my future life wasn't the plan that God had for me. And so, it definitely wasn't the plan for me. It may have seemed like it in my head, but it really wasn't. And perhaps I'd been so wrapped up in my wanting to be seen as traditionally successful and not letting down any of people, especially my parents, that I hadn't stopped to consider any other career opportunities. And once I did accept God's calling on my life, once I changed my major and went on a totally different path, which shocked my roommate, to say the least, I had such joy in my life. I felt inspired by my classes rather than just being there. The plan I took from that day on wasn't my best laid plan, but it had been God's for me. In both of our scripture passages for today, we see glimpses of how two different people's best laid plans for their lives are changed by God's interruption to bring them onto God's plan for them and subsequently for all of us. In the reading from 2 Samuel today, David has a plan to build the temple for God. Up until this point, the people of Israel had used a tabernacle as the center point for their worship of God. The tabernacle is a tent the people created way back in the book of Exodus after escaping from Egypt. King David was not the first king of the people, but he is the first king of all the tribes of Israel. And the first big building project David takes on after securing his kingship is to build himself a house, aka a palace. This sets the stage for the entire scene in verse 2. The king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." David had a place to settle himself and wanted to build something worthy of God, the God of his people. The prophet Nathan originally says, "Sounds good." But then he goes home and he has a prophecy where God tells Nathan to tell David, "Nuh-uh, nope, nope, don't do that. A temple can wait a little while longer." David's best laid plan was to build a palace for himself, to really hammer home that he is the king of all of Israel, and then to build a temple worthy of the God of the universe. God's plan, however, is different. God's more than happy to continue to dwell in the tabernacle tent for a little while longer, and instead will give the job to David's son, Solomon, the second king of the United Kingdom of Israel. And yet, that's also not all of God's plan. God's plan is just so much bigger than David and Solomon. Instead, God's plan includes a promised king from David's line for his chosen people. David's big plan was to settle down himself and then settle down God's place in Jerusalem. God's plan was much, much greater. God's the one in control, and it's God's timing that truly matters. David fought many battles and wars to establish himself as king, and God was more than happy to wait until a fully established Israel to have a temple built for God's presence to dwell. And from David's lineage, God is promising a Messiah, which means anointed one in Hebrew. A Messiah, a king to establish David's line forever. This king, this Messiah, is Jesus Christ, the one we're waiting for, the one who shows just how much God truly loves us. As is the way with God, God breaks through Mary's best laid plans too. God sends the angel Gabriel to tell Mary that her plan to marry Joseph is fine, but God's going to intervene first for quite the miraculous moment. Mary's plan to marry Joseph and raise a family with him. They were going to have a simple peasant life. This would have very likely been an arranged marriage that hopefully would have included mutual care and affection. Mary's plan did not, in all capitals, did not include carrying the Son of God in her womb and then raising him as part of her family. And yet this was God's plan. God's plan took the structure of hers and magnified it. It painted her as a potential outcast for getting pregnant before marriage. And Mary's only question to Gabriel the angel is, how can this be, since I'm a virgin? And getting pregnant before your official marriage ceremony was something that could have gotten Mary killed for being an adulterer. And yet with Gabriel's answer of how it'll come to pass, Mary doesn't question anymore. She gives her consent to the most mind-boggling change of plans. And God supports her by ensuring that Joseph stays by her side. That part of her life plan remains the same, with everything else up in the air. God provides for her when God's plan changes and interrupts her own. In these two instances and the acceptances they both give to say the okay to God's way, they inspire us all these centuries later to do the same thing. To say yes when God's plan becomes clear and shows us the best plan for us, even when it's the opposite of our best laid plans. I don't know what this will look like in your lives today, next week, a year from now. What I do know is God will speak into your life in some way. That could be a closed door, but an open window, as the phrase goes. It could be in a repeated idea you just can't shake. It could be someone speaking into your life with a new to you idea that resonates in ways you wouldn't imagine. God's plan for your life with 5 years left to live can be just as impactful with 50 years left to live. So trust in God's plan for you, for the church, for this world. We know God's love lives in and through us because the gift of Advent, the gift of Christ's long-awaited birth, and how we're changed, adopted, and inspired by the truth of this love. So trust in God's plan, and when you see shimmers of it, follow it. For God's plan is always the best laid plan. Amen. Please stand as you are able in body or spirit to join our next hymn, number 28, Good Christian Friends Rejoice.
Apostles' Creed. It can be found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. Third day again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. So at the time in our service when we share our joys and concerns, and we'll start with the congregation. Do we have any joys or concerns? Oh, we hear from Grandma Paulette.
We have a new family member. She was born Friday, Reagan Josephine, 6 pounds, 8 ounces. Mom and baby are doing great.
God of mercy, hear our prayers. God's greatest gift. Yes.
One second.
Hey, Donna.
My very good friend, Carol Mullen, I had reported they thought she had pancreas problems. She has pancreatic cancer, and she also has tumors on her lung, which she's going for a biopsy for on Tuesday. So please, please keep her in your prayers.
Certainly will. God have mercy. Hear our prayers. And it's certainly a joy to see Pat Walker with us today. Nice to see you, Pat, on the road to recovery.
Walter. Prayers for Betty Martin.
Continued prayers for Betty Martin. God have mercy, hear our prayers. Joanne.
And Marion Kopeck.
And Marion Kopeck. Prayers for Marion Kopeck as well. And her family. God have mercy, hear our prayers. Are there any others in the congregation?
I have one from Cheryl Deckmar. She's asked us several times to pray for a family close to her, the Horniak family, and the last person who was sick has now died. And so that would be Gail Pollard. I think that's my best guess to say her last name, but Gail. And so prayers for the whole Horniak family. They've had so much death since Thanksgiving. Even so, prayers for them.
God have mercy, hear our prayers. Yeah, Tom.
That's how I get my exercise. I feel like Walt is like Phil Donahue when he runs around with the microphone. prayers for my mother. We recently found out this week that she has lung cancer. So it's going to be a difficult time the next 6 months or so. So thank you.
God have mercy. Hear our prayers. So sorry. Are there any others? Are there any on Zoom, Eric? Barbara.
Yes, I wanted to say thank you to everybody's prayers for our son.
Barbara, just wait one moment.
Okay, I'm sorry.
There we go.
Go ahead.
You can tell her to go now.
Go ahead now,
okay,
Barbara.
Thank you. Prayers for our son, Brian. He's still in the hospital and he's doing better. And we're so thankful for that. And thank everyone for the prayers and thoughts.
God have mercy, hear our prayers. Any others on Zoom? I don't see Betty on Zoom today.
Looks like it. So she was on there, but she's not.
She was on?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't see.
Are there any others? Okay.
So with all of these joys and concerns shared and in our hearts, let us now pray. Please join me in prayer. Living God, who came down to this world as a shining light to brighten all the recesses and alcoves of the world, help us to reflect your light into this world of distrust, disdain, and hate. Unite your entire church to work for peace and prosperity to the entire world. Amazing God, you crafted this world with connection in mind, and because we turn from you, we find so many things difficult, including the care of one another. In our prayer this morning, we pray for the people you've placed on our hearts as a reminder of the importance of listening for and respecting the needs of others. We pray for the Horniak family as they mourn the loss of Gail. We pray for Carol and her pancreatic cancer diagnosis. We pray for Betty and Marion as they mourn the loss of their husband and mom. We pray for Mrs. Allheit, Tom's mother, with her recent diagnosis of lung cancer. We pray for Brian as he continues to recover from his surgery on his esophagus. We thank you that he's doing better, but we pray for his continued healing. King of Kings, you are the true ruler of this world, and so we pray that our elected officials and the leaders around the world will work together to find common unity and common ground. May the war cease, and may weapons be turned into instruments of provision, just as your prophets envisioned. Almighty God, we're in awe by all that you do for us, day in and day out. You provide so much. You've even given us the gift of prayer. And we thank you for this connection that reminds us of the needs of humanity, ourselves, and others. We thank you for the ways we see your hope and your light and your love glimmer, like in the birth of Reagan Josephine and the joy she's already bringing to her family. We thank you that the birth went well and that mom and daughter are both well. And for Pat Walker being with us in the sanctuary today, we thank you, O God, for those blessings. We thank you also, God, for the gift of the Lord's Prayer, which we will now pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now Rich Hazler is coming forward.
Oh, I'm going to sing a solo first, but that's okay. I better not. Today concludes the Christmas joy offering, and I appreciate the introduction musically and the opportunity to just thank you all for contributing to it. It goes to the pension funds for Presbyterian ministers, it also to support workers and their families if in emergencies. And it also goes to students who go to Presbyterian colleges to be ministers and pursue education and prepare to bring their gifts to the service of all of us in congregations. So let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the good news of Christmas and Jesus, the perfect gift. As we hasten to bring him, Lord, with loving hearts, bless our gifts and bless our giving to the Christmas joy offering that needs may be met and that all may know your love. Amen.
Amen.
And Merry Christmas.
Let us magnify the Lord, rejoicing in the one who scatters the proud, lifts up the lowly, and fills the hungry with good things. Let us offer our lives to the Lord with generous hearts and minds to the work God is doing in and through us and this congregation. remain standing and join me in our unison prayer of dedication as printed in the bulletin or on the screen. God of love, your Son came to light our paths, to bring connection and guidance to our lives. Use us and the offerings we give to the church today and always to support and grow your kingdom here on earth. Help us, O God, to be joyful givers in all aspects of our lives. In Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It's now the time where we share announcements, and I really want to say Merry Christmas. The big announcement is, of course, we are having our Lessons and Carols candlelight service tonight at 7:30 p.m. And the other, Joanne.
I want to thank everybody who paid for flowers, and if you could take them home tonight, it would be much appreciated. We would like to all enjoy them for one more service. Thank you.
Thank you, Joanne. Any other announcement? Oh, yes, go ahead. Speak into that microphone.
There are candy canes in the back for anyone who would like to grab one on the way out. We have plenty more. We don't want to have them for the whole year. So if you'd like a candy cane, please help yourself.
Thank you. Phil? I think Phil wants to say something.
Tomorrow happens to be Pastor Catherine's birthday. So besides wishing you a Merry Christmas, we all wish you a happy birthday as well.
Aw, thank you, Phil.
Happy birthday.
Woohoo! No. Okay, so with that in mind, I think we can now turn to our closing hymn, number 23, Angels We Have Heard on High. Please stand as you are able, in body or in spirit. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.